come downstairs, lads. I'm walking out to school, and all of a sudden, she like 400 dudes. I'm like, yo. So he said, yo, there you go, he right there. And that's when I knew it was waiting for me.
You said you got transferred from another high school and had to go to Westinghouse?
Yeah, yeah. So what happened was, first I had started out in Bishop Lockland, right? And that's downtown. So I had already had a little, like, experience with the whole downtown shit. But to be honest with you, like, my aunt used to work at a movie theater called Duffield down in downtown back in the days. So, you know, I was always spending time downtown. And like I had mentioned before, you know, my mom was on Heroin, man. So, you know, being one of them Heroin babies, man, you go everywhere with your moms, you know what I'm saying? I tell people all the time, like, a Heroin addict is different from a crack addict because a Heroin addict, they got like that whole family community vibe. They stick together, you know what I'm saying? Back in the days. And then, you know, then when crack came out, it was a whole different energy. Like, crackheads just was going crazy.
Yeah, they said when crack came out, that was the first drug that actually made a woman abandon their children. You know what I mean? Facts. People that was on dope, they still tried to be a mother or a father.
Facts. They stayed together. The family, you should see like a dope thing family. They be together, the kids, the father, the mother, everybody. But then like crack came different. But you know, my mom was a functioning addict. You know what I'm saying? She always worked, kept a good job. She also, you know, kept me fresh, and she also, you know, put me in the best school she could. So, you know, she had, you know, living in the Ville, coming from the Ville, she didn't want me to go to Jeff. She didn't want me to go to Boys and Girls. So she was like, you know, she went down there and she begged and cried and did everything she could to get me in a locker. Somehow it worked, champ. Got me in locker and shit. So I started out there. But so I was going downtown, and being from Brownsville and going downtown, we had, you know, we kind of stuck together, you know, especially us coming from the towers. Anybody from the towers, we rode the A train, the C train together. We got off at Lafayette. But when you got off at Lafayette, it was on because there was some dudes around. There was a dude at the time named Pat. It was a couple dudes, man, that was really, you know, they was out there, they was doing their thing, whatever, they was thugging. And they used to come to Bishop Lockwood after school, and before school, after school, it was on, you know what I'm saying? So I had my experience with downtown, you know what I mean? And then they kicked me out of Wingate. You know, they kicked me out of Lockwood. I went to Wingate. That was a whole other animal. I was crazy. I was like, I couldn't believe it. You know, coming from private school, going to Wingate. I remember like the second day of school, first day of school, it was a man sitting next to me in the classroom. I know, so this man had to be like 40-something years old. I was like 16, if that is 15, 16. I was like, what the hell is going on? So that was a deadly experience. So then,
What you mean? He was a dude that was still in high school, that was grown?
Bro, back, this was like 86, man. This was like 86 for sure. And, it was a grown man, son. It was like somebody pops. He was a grown man. I guess they ain't had no limit or whatever on the ages, but this was a grown man. He was a dread too. And I remember going to school saying to myself, I ain't gonna make it. I remember saying to myself, first day, I ain't gonna make it. And that was crazy too, because I wound up going to Wingate. And prior to that, I had a fight with a dude. And I was living in East Flatbush at the time. And I had a fight with a dude, a street fight with this dude. And he had tried to cut me with a razor. He had cut my shirt up real bad. And I was like, damn, I was going through it. Now, I was new to the neighborhood. So I remember that. I remember going to my block. He came to my block, but like, he came deep. Came to my uncle crib. He wanted to fight me. And I was like, yo, I can't get into no fights over here because, you know, me and my moms had got kicked out of the towers. We was living at my uncle's crib at the time, and it wasn't really comfortable because, you know, it was somebody else's crib, and you know what I'm saying, like, you can't come over there with the beef and all that. So I was stressed out. And then they came to the crib, they rolled up deep to the crib. And I never forget, because I lived on East 46th Street between Lincoln and Lenox, and it was crazy because the dudes from Full Force, it was a group called Full Force back in the days, they lived right across the street from me. So when they seen all these dudes come to the block, they was like, you know, they stepped up and they was like, yo, what's up? So he was like, yo, we're beefing. So they said for us to take it around the corner. I was like, damn. So we went around the corner and me and dudes started fighting, bro. And it was like,
you mean a group full force themselves told y'all to take the beef around the corner?
That ass. They came to the group, the muscle dudes with the Jerry curls. They was good dudes, man. They used to just be chilling. They was, you know, well, that block was live, lad. Like, everybody used to be on that block. Chubb Rock, UTFO. Everybody that was running with full force, they was on that block. Now, my cousin is Dr. Ice from UTFO.
I got Dr. Ice autograph in McDonald's on Pickin Avenue, like, when they was killing the game, you feel me? Caught them right. In McDonald's, got them to sign a picture and all of that.
Yeah, that's my cousin. That's my blood cousin.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so I guess, you know, that being my cousin and they seeing a whole crew, a whole posse come to the crib, it was a bad look. I didn't want to, you know, nothing. I didn't want my uncle and them to be tripping. So I was like, yo, just leave him from front of the crib. Now, mind you, this dude was like, I thought he was my man. He was cool. And, he just flipped out on me. We was stupid young. I used to, you know, somebody let you hold some batteries, like, you know, batteries, you're going to use them shits up. So he was like, yo, let me borrow your batteries, right, for his box. So I let him hold the batteries. And, you know, remember back in the day, you used to say, yo, put the batteries in the refrigerator, in the freezer, and then charge up, right? So I'm telling him, yo, I need my batteries, man. He like, yo, whatever. He ain't saying nothing, whatever. I guess he used the batteries up. So I went to his block. He lived on 45th. I went to his block. I was like, yo, what's up with my batteries? He came out the window. He was beefing with me, roll up. And then he just started gunning the batteries down at me, son. Hard as he could, throwing them at my head. I'm like, no. Throwing the batteries. Son.
They was D's? They was D batteries?
Big D batteries, son. He gunned them at my head. And they hit the cars and different shit. I'm like, no. But he was a little off. I ain't gonna front. You know, he was a little off and shit. So he came downstairs and, you know, I swear he was my man. So, you know what I mean? I ain't thinking nothing of it. I'm thinking, you know, I'm just going to be beef or whatever. And he came out with a razor, son, and he just started going ham and cheese on me. And by the grace, man, I just, like, ducked up out of there, got and cut my shirt. It was my favorite shirt. I got that from King's Plaza, man. I was rocking this shirt. I was rocking this shirt so much, it was wearing itself. And he cut the shirt up. I was like, damn. So I just got out of there, ran to the crib, like, yo. So then he came to the crib deep with some dudes. So I'm like, yo, you know, I'm thinking it's my man. So he really upset, tight, ready to kill me. I'm obviously so full force of them see that. They come across the street, they're like, yo, what's up? They're like, you know, whatever. They have the words. And they said, take it around the corner. So I'm like, yeah, I'm just hoping they was going to squash this shit. They're like, nah, take it around the corner. So I'm like, nah, I can't say no, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I'm new to the neighborhood. So I go around the corner and we start fighting. You know, I ain't gonna front. At the time in my life, last, that was the hardest fight I ever had. Like, I had never had a fight where somebody was trying to hurt me like that, like really kill me, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So me and him going at it, and I'm doing my thing, boom, he was West Indian. I remember him kicking me bad times, kicking me. I'm like, yeah, where the fuck is he getting these kicks from? And finally, you know, I being from Brownsville, you know, we used to slap box fight all the time, you know, with your hands and all that, 52 and all that, you know, we grew up learning that shit. So I'm fighting him, he kicking me and all type of shit. So finally, I put the 1-2 on him and get him on the ground. And you know how, like, when somebody put your arms on your knees on your arms?
Yeah.
I had him on his back with his knees, my knees on his arms, and I just started drilling him, son. I started drilling him. And it wasn't that serious, but when I seen what he was trying to do to me, it made me realize that, yo, this is another level of fighting with this dude. So I drilled him out. I mean, I started like just punching him hard as I could in his face. I was sitting on his knees, and I pretty much waxed him real, real bad. So after that, I got out, and that was it, I thought. You know, he came back with some more dudes, bro. And they had a hammer on them. And this time my uncle and them was home, so they kind of seen something was going on. And I was worried that my aunt was going to kick me out and shit. So that was like, okay, so I knew was crazy because at the time I wasn't going to school, because once I got kicked out of Lachlan, I kind of just sat the whole year at home. That was in like, say I got kicked out in like, you know, I say like December. That was it. I ain't go to no more school. You know what I'm saying? So I was just sitting around or going on the train and just doing crazy shit. So now I go to Wingate the next year. And that's his school. Now, you know what I'm saying? That's his school. And all the dudes that he had brought to my crib, they went there too. So I got in here like, this ain't gonna work. This ain't gonna happen. I mean, something gonna happen. So I was thinking about, damn, maybe I should go to Boys and Girls. But I wrote it out and I made a name for myself. I started fighting at Wingate, and somebody noticed me and was like, yo, you got some hands, what's up? And I was like, well, you know what I mean? So that, and to be honest with you, Laz, that led to me becoming a boxer, because in that same school, I kept getting noticed. Like, people was like, yo, you be fighting, what's up with that? Like, you know what I'm saying? You got some hands. And after about three or four fights, different fights, an older dude said, yo, I want to take you to a boxing gym. And I was like, nah, I ain't with that shit. He was like, nah, I'm telling you. So we made some stupid bet. And the bet, I wound up losing. And dude just kept coming to me all the time, like, yo, what's up? You lost that bet. You got to go to the gym. So he had a car. So it was like, all right, fuck it. I'm going to you know, I'm gonna get this ride with son to the gym. And, you know, it's something to do. Plus, I wasn't doing shit. And when we went to go to the gym, he was like, nah, we ain't taking my car. We taking the bus. I was like, you bugging the bus from East Flatbush to where? He said, Starry City. I said, nah, that's not going to happen, champ. But he talked me into it, so we went out there today. We went all the way out to Starry City, and that's how I started boxing. But fast forward to now I'm in Wingate. I'm rocking out. I got the hands. Everybody know me. I'm becoming real popular. I was a nice guy. Everybody knew me. I was funny, you know, bugged out. But I wasn't going to suffer. You know, I could fight. So I started wilding out of Wingate, though. I started wilding out because I was having too much fun. I was, you know what I'm saying? I wasn't really going to school to learn nothing, to be honest with you. I was just going to school to link up with other brothers that was going on missions or whatever, was going boosting, or, you know, talk about going out of town to hustle. It was like, really, school was just a place for me to go to and to get free lunch, you know what I'm saying? And not to get, you know, locked up from the truant offices and shit. So after a while, they're like, yo, you gotta get out. So they said, yo, if you want to graduate or like any type of shit, you gotta go get some credits. So they sent me to Western House. So during this time, I was kind of like, I was rocking a lot of Polo. You know what I'm saying? I had lived in the Garvey, so I knew, you know, Vic Lowe and Beck Lowe and, you know, Ski, all of them was my people. We grew up together. So then we was in high school together. So it was like, okay, it was obvious. Plus, you know, I'm trying to get fresh anyway. And I wound up, I don't know, I had to course some low here, course some low there. Before you know it, I got like four or five low outfits that I could move around, you know what I'm saying? I'm looking pretty good, you know what I'm saying? So they said, yo, you gotta go to Western House. But I had already knew that Western House, the downtown, not even Western House, but I had heard about Western House. But I knew downtown wasn't no joke, because mind you, back up a little bit, I'm talking about like 82, lads. I went to LIU. They had a summer camp at LIU. And it was like 83. And it was deep. Fort Greene was deep in LIU. And the second or third day, son, I don't know how they found out from Brownsville or what happened, but son, I had beef with the whole camp. The whole camp was like, yo, we get you after camp. I was like, what? So, man, that was like some crazy shit. I got out of there by like the skin on my ass. I got out of there, son. I had never forget. It was crazy. So my Fort Greene experiences was like, yo, the boys down there don't play. But it was, you know, it was only two places that you really felt like, yo, Brownsville and Fort Greene was like, you know what I'm saying, some real shit you need to be worried about. So fast forward, Matt, well, I'm in Western House. I go through the first couple of days, I don't see nothing popping, everything good. I'm like, all right, cool. And I'll never forget, I had met this girl named Doris. And she was a bad one. And she was like, you know, but I wasn't coming fresh for a reason. I was trying to, you know, scope out the situation first. So, you know what I mean? So after a couple of days, this nice girl, I don't see nothing popping but some nice looking chuck honeys, you know what I'm saying? So I said, all right, it's a go. So I come through one day with the low ski pants, with the vest, with the, you know what I'm saying? I'm about to put it together. Everybody looking at me like, oh wow, shorty's giving me rhythm and all that. So I said, okay, I'm gonna come back on him. So the next day I come through again on him, fly. This time I got something totally different on. And boy, why'd I do that? Man, I swear to God, champ, before night school was over, I kind of felt something was in the air, man. And I came out. I think it was like you switch class. I had like two classes at night or whatever. And I switched classes and I peeped. There was a couple new people, faces that I ain't see. And I peeped how they was peeping me. So I was like, all right, you know, it is what it is. And then I go downstairs. You know, everything in New York, wintertime, everything get dark early. So I come downstairs, lads. I'm walking out to school and all of a sudden, see like 400 dudes. I'm like, yo. So, and real talk, they could have had me, cause I still think, well, maybe not, you know what I'm saying? But one of them said, yo, there he go. And I said, oh shit, and I backed right back into the building. When he said that, cause I was playing like between the doors a second, looking out, peeping it. And then I guess he must have came out. I went out there while he was seeing what I was doing. He said, yo, there you go, he right there. And that's when I knew they was waiting for me. So I walk back in school. I come back to look outside. They coming in now. I'm like, oh, it's on. All of a sudden, they said, yo, come here. I took off. I started running. They started chasing me. This is crazy, because this ain't my school. So I'm low-key, like, I'm just running wild, trying to figure out. Get out of here, son. But I had a razor in my pocket. I had an only box cutter, son. So I'm running, I'm running, I'm jumping downstairs, I'm running. I'm like, yo, if they catch me somewhere by myself, this is rap. I seen a whole bunch of custodians. I ran up on them, yo, trying to kill me. It was like, what? I'm here, trying to kill me. Yo, blessings, son. It was one of my times, I got blessed, son. He said, yo, stay right here. He pushed me in like a little room. I heard them all running. Boom, 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 boom. Yo, where he at? See anybody down here? Y'all gotta get out of here. And they scream, nah, he down here. So I'm thinking, yo, son, they gonna kill me, son. I'm thinking it's a wrap. So now, mind you, I'm thinking back to the eight early when I'm a kid going to LIU, you know, with the little Long Island University. So I'm like, yo, these four green dudes is animals, yo.
For the record, these dudes is only chasing you just because you was low down and niggas wanted that low jacket?
They wanted everything, son. They wanted everything. I guess they wanted the low. They wanted to know who I thought I was to come through like that. You know what I'm saying? And I was like, yo, they can't get me, son. They get me. Because the whole thing back then was, you know, back in the 80s, man, everything was about getting that buck 50. You know what I'm saying? Like, not getting the buck 50 or giving somebody one. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it was like a fad. Everybody getting cut or cutting. So I was like, I ain't trying to get cut, man. You know what I'm saying? I'm on some light skin shit back then. So I'm like, you know, I ain't trying to get my face cut. You know what I'm saying? So I get out running high and doing all types of shit. So finally, the dude come back and said, man, you gotta get out of here, man. I don't know what you did to them boys, but you gotta. I said, I ain't doing nothing to these. I got it. So I said, yo, can you get me out? He said, you can't go that way. But then they wound up locking the front gate. So I'm in there bugging, like, yo. So finally, I'm cognitive plea. I'm trying to figure this shit out. And they said, yo, come here. They took me another door. They said, took me to the door, pushed me out the door, and closed it. Now, mind you, this is like on the back side of Western House. So I'm like, yo, I'm dead. So I come out. Never forget. Come out. I started running.
What time was it by the time you got out that building, though?
Son, it was like 9 o'clock. 9:30, something late. Something crazy. Like, and you know, it's winter, so it's mad dark. So I'm thinking, yo, it's a wrap. I'm over. So I'm running down the street. I'm running down the street. Like, yo, I'm thinking to myself, get to Atlantic Avenue. Now, mind you, I get to Atlantic Avenue. Atlantic Avenue was a lot different back then. You know what I'm saying? It was nasty. You know what I'm saying? With abandoned buildings, it was this, that. So I'm on Atlantic Avenue now. I'm running down Atlantic Avenue. I'm running towards the towers. But then it hit me. you don't want to go down that way because you got Kingsboro. You know what I'm saying? You got all type of shit on the way. So I'm just thinking, I hit Flatbush Avenue. I take off towards Flatbush Avenue. I was like, yo, made it up to my Prospect Plaza. Prospect Park. And then I walked it on down to East Flatbush, man. And I was like, yo, I never went back to the school, son. I never went back to that shit. I was like, nah, they out to get me. So then they put me in Erasmus Night School. And same shit, repeat, son. Repeat. Because they knew I was from Wingate. You know what I'm saying? So I'm rocking in there for like a week. Then he stepped to me. Yo, what's up? What's up? They're like, yo, where you from? From Brownsville. My word, that's what we thought. They knew I was from Wingate, you know what I'm saying? So I'm rocking in there for like a week. Then he stepped to me. Yo, what's up? What's up? They're like, yo, where you from? From Brownsville. My word, that's what we thought. And I was like, oh, that was a sign. So
I played this. And they were straight, straight Flatbush?
Straight Flatbush. Was straight about it. It was on me, son. Again, I was stunting. I was getting shorties. I was coming through. I had a shorty in there. She was digging me. She was an older chick. She the one put me on. She the one. She was like, yo. She was like, yo, you gotta watch yourself. And I was like, huh? I remember like telling her, I said, what you mean? She was like, yo, it's eyes on you. And she was an older chick. Her name was Doris. That's where I met her at. She was from Flatbush. And she was like, yo, they on you, yo. She like, for real, like, between me and you, the guy they planning on. Cause she went there during the day and she went there at night too to graduate, you know what I'm saying? Get some credits or whatever. And Doris put me on. She was like, yo, they on you, chat. And I was like, word. So that was the end of my Erasmus days too. Like, you know, growing up with my parents, like my mom was doing something called the program. It used to be one on Hopkinson. And it used to be one on Powell Street over there in Brownsville. So when you grow up, it's called the program, ARTC. When you grow up on the program, which you like, you go everywhere and you know everybody, kind of low key, like you know everybody. You in every project, you know what I'm saying? I'm in everywhere. So I always had this thing, man. I grew up with this thing like, yo, you gotta have juice. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got no juice, you gonna get. You know what I'm saying? You gonna get it because you there's too many places. Like my grandmother lived in Plaza. Noble Drew. I lived in the Towers. Then we moved to Garvey. Then we moved back to the Towers. And then my cousins lived in Van Dyke. My cousins lived in Riverdale. I had family in Brownsville and Langston Hughes. So for me, I went everywhere. I was a kid. I'm 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. But I'm going to every project. So that felt like, yo, I know somebody everywhere. And that same mentality, I do that about Brooklyn. I do that. I'd be like, yo, if you can live in Brownsville and go to every project and everybody know you or know somehow you can live, I know I could go any other neighborhood. So when I went to Flatbush and I went to East Flatbush and I went to, you know, any neighborhood I went to, I always felt like I could be all right because I was from the Ville. That mentality was good. But at the same time, you know, I'm blessed, man. I could have got murked, son. I did a lot of crazy shit. I told you, I was one time in East New York. My family from Pink Houses, and my cousin Shanique, and she from Pink Houses. And I was over there and got caught slipping. I was in a store called Milk Jug. It's had a store now. I don't know if it's still there. It's called Milk Jug. And I was in Milk Jug, man. It was dead empty. Nobody was in there. I mean, yeah. During the daytime, I walk in, I'm thinking, you know, everything good. I got that lotion on again. And some dudes came in, my boy. They came in deep. And I had already heard many stories. Because, you know, when you're young, you want to know everything. You want to know everything. I mean, being from Brooklyn, yo, who's this, who's that? You're hearing all the stories of this person, legend, that legend. So who is the legendary A-team? You know what I'm saying? And I was like, you know what I'm saying? I'm in the store chilling, whatever I'm doing, going to get something, making it quick. And they came in on me, my boy. And it was like, yo, who the fuck is this? And I was like, because I had on this shit. I'm tall, light skinned. I got a flat top. I kid and play. And I had a big polo, like a air warmers, like a you wear it over your head, like, you know what I'm saying? But my head was sticking out and shit. So like a headband. It was colorful. It had the big badge on it.
Oh yeah, I know what you're talking about. Yeah, yeah. It's like the thick. Crazy. It's like the thick ass. It's like a thick ass headband.
Yeah, thick shit. So now my hair's sticking out. You know what I'm saying? I'm going around pink houses because I had a couple of shorties that like me. You know what I'm saying? I'm going around here showing my face, and I'm something new. I'm somebody new. And I'm Sydney's cousin. I'm Sean's cousin. So it's like okay. So I go through there and I'm forget, man. This dude walk in and they say, yo, Pig. And I knew the name. And they was like, yo, what the fuck? He ain't Pig. So, yo, what the fuck is this? And, yo, it was rap. I think they got me. I was like, they got me, son. I didn't know what to do. And I had that orange box cutter in my pocket, son. And I never forget. I put my hands in my pocket and I took the safety off and I clicked it one time. Like, damn, it's up. I kept always telling myself, I said to myself, if I cut this dude, my boy, man, I'm finished. You know what I'm saying? I'm thinking to myself, if I cut this dude, I'm finished. So at that time, my boy, I don't know how it happened, lads, but the blessings, man, God saved me, champ. My cousin walked in. I don't even know how. Then she went to Franklin Lane. I think she went to Franklin Lane or something.
But how many niggas, you? This is when you was in the store still, you said?
I was in the store.
How many niggas was it? And what type of, what, like, you had mad polo shit on?
Mad polo. I had the vest on with the ski man on the back. I had the shirt. I had the, you know, it was a short, it was a vest. So I had the shirt on. It had a fucking badge, a crest on the arm. I had the thing on my head. I had my ski pants on. I was rocking it. You know what I'm saying? I had on some Reeboks, I think, or some shit. And it was crazy, you know, now that I think about it, they was outside. They was outside. They wasn't outside when I pulled up, when I walked in, but they just came formed outside. So I'm in the store procrastinating. I'm in the store procrastinating, like, yo. So walk out, mind my business, don't say nothing. They ain't gonna say nothing, just keep it moving. Before that, they walk in. Son said, yo, who the fuck is this? And I'm just like, God, I'm trying to, like, ignore him. Yeah, all of a sudden, my boy was getting heated. And my cousin came out of nowhere, bro. Yo, bro, I don't know how to tell you how I had so many calls, supposed calls last. I ain't gonna front. My life is crazy.
You said it was Pig that said, yo, who the fuck is this?
It was Pig. My boy was him himself. It was him himself. I cause you know what I'm saying? I was already glued to the streets as far as food. He knew my cousin. So she was pretty, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, everybody liked her. She was her name, Shanique. Everybody liked her. So, plus I had my cousin Gloria. She was from there. She was saying, cousin Gloria, Felicia. You know what I'm saying? We all, you know, they from there. So they had me, you know what I'm saying? They had enough. And it was pretty. Everybody liked it. So everybody knew them. So, yo, my cousin came out of nowhere. Yo, what's up? I'm like, she loud as shit. I'm like, yo, what's up? He like, yo, Sean, who the fuck is this? She like, that's my cousin, Pig. Leave my cousin alone. She was like, he was like, yo, son, this nigga don't be coming around here with this fuck. Yeah, he like, he screamed, he barked on me. I was, you got it, champ. I was like, yo, you got it, champ. So I was like, you know what I mean? I took it on the chin, walked it off. So I was like, yo, now I'm thinking, damn, I went to a crib, and as usual, I used to be like, damn, why did I come over here so late? She got to go home, you feel me? Cause at the time it was, you know, dead on. Then it was like stories of dead on was out there. You know what I mean? So it's like, yo, my cousin, I never forget. She used to tell me when I'm leaving. I used to sometimes leave 2 a.m, 3 a.m, summertime. She'd be like, don't let dead on get you. I'd be like, oh shit, yeah. And that was the most scariest shit. I used to take up staircase. I can still remember how them staircases smelling pink houses, man. And I used to get out of there, man. I used to walk through the projects, headed to the, at the time I was living on Milford Street, man. I was living next door to this crack house, dead ass. This crack house was so busy, son. I think the police owned the crack house. because I never seen no shit like this. The lines were so crazy, lad, for this crack house, my boy. You know, I never seen no shit like this. And then the cops would pull up. They cleared for like 2 minutes. Or they wouldn't even clear. The cops would go in, come out, and the lines still be rocking. You know what I'm saying? I never seen no, and it was right across the street from where I was living. So I was just watching this shit. Like, I'm talking about little streets, Milford Street. This little street, and I'm looking at this shit all day and night. Like, wow. This is wild, crazy. And I remember living there and saying to myself, yo, this shit is crazy, man. So I was fortunate, lads, when my man in high school said, yo, go to this boxing gym with me. You feel me? Because that was life changing, man. My life was ruined, man. My pops was in jail. Was he in jail at the time? He might have got caught. Yeah. My pops was on the run for a while. He was on America's Most Wanted. And then my mom's was doing bad. It was just me, so I was just out there in the streets, and it wasn't for, you know what I'm saying, this dude named Zach, he the one told me to go to the gym with him. Yeah, that was life-changing, my boy. I was living all over Brooklyn. I was homeless. I got arrested a few times. That was my biggest fear was going to the island. And that's why I'm a big fan of what you're doing, Nathan. I appreciate you. You're a great storyteller as well, and I be listening because that was the whole thing. I was fighting, man. I was fighting not to get locked up. But it seemed like at the time I was trying to get locked up because that's where all my homies was at. That's how everybody was like, yo. It was kind of like a rites of passage, you know what I mean? It's like, yo, oh, you ain't been locked up? You know what I'm saying? You saw me, you ain't been locked up. Well, whoops. I was just like, damn, I just gotta go ahead and get locked up. And a few times I got arrested, I was thinking like, well, I'm going to the island. And it was like, nah, you get out on bail or whatever. So it wasn't even the art awesome shit. And I was fortunate, man, because I remember going to see my pops last on the island when he had finally got caught, and he was sitting there. My pops, my stepops, he raised me, and he was like, yo, he was crying on the visit. He was crying, his tears in his eyes. And my mom was telling him that I was wilding out. I wasn't, you know, listening. I was just on some missions and shit, I was rebelling. I was hard. I was hurt. You know what I'm saying? I lost my crib in the towers. Yeah, got evicted. You know what I'm saying? My life had went from, you know, private school. And then here I am. I'm sleeping on the train. I'm sleeping in an abandoned building. I'm sleeping anywhere I could. You know what I mean? This wasn't a kid. This was from a kid who grew up having Christmas toys. And every birthday I had a party. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, I just came home from school one day, lads, and we got evicted. It wasn't like no, you know, nothing prepared me for what was to come. I mean, I wasn't planning on being no boxer. You know what I'm saying? I'm the only child, no brothers and sisters. I was bullied, you know what I'm saying? They used to beat me up, you know what I'm saying? But I'll fight back, you know what I'm saying? Sometimes they made me fight back. You know, the older dudes in the building, they made me fight back. It was like, yo, they knew my mom. Everybody loved my mom. My mom was like a neighborhood celebrity. You know what I'm saying? Everybody loved Margie. And, you know what I'm saying? Miss Margie. Everybody called her Miss Margie, Miss Margie. So it was crazy because sometimes I couldn't know. I'd come home and I got the enemy, you know, in my crib. I'd be like, yo, mom, what are you doing here? Be like two or three boys from another street, like from Herkimer or some shit or from. I'd be like, mom, what you doing? Be like, mom, he helped me carry the bags or. Boy, yeah, I know his mother. He a good boy. I'd be like, oh, man. And they'd be sitting there smiling because they just was happy to come into the crib. You know what I'm saying? They was happy to come into the towers. And then they in my house. They looking around like, oh, this how y'all living? So that was like something. My mom's always happy, you know, friends with other friends and shit. I'm like, wow, nah, them boys don't like us. This, that, and third. So I went from living good last to living like, scoundrel, like living everywhere, stealing money. I mean, stealing fruit from the food stand. It was days I ain't eat. I used to go buy a food stand on Belmont or anywhere, take some apples or some oranges or anything, son. That was like, you know, that was a little bit of fool. So you know, when I got into the boxing, that kind of changed up everything. Because now, when I had no place to sleep, I sleep in the gym sometimes, and then dudes would be like, yo, I spoil you. Just give me $5. I'd use the $5, go get me 4 chicken wings and french fries. And, you know, if I was, you know, we would buy it. If I was lucky, I had 5 or 6. I get the pork fried rice with it instead of the fries, you know what I mean? So I used to, you know, that was a lifestyle for me for a minute. And then unfortunately, after one of my run-ins with the law, one of my last run-ins with the law as a kid, I went to the gym and it was like, yo, you should be facing 5 years. And my pops, I was gonna go back to my pops. What happened to see my pops in jail? And you know, he was a tough man. He was a big tough dude. And he had cries and cried to his eyes. He said, Shannon, this ain't for you. You know what I'm saying? And he was in day-to-day visiting room. He was like, this ain't for you. I was looking around, feeling everything. I was watching everything, looking at everything to see. I kept asking stupid questions. Yo, did you see my friend so-and-so? You see, he's sitting here trying to tell me, yo, take care of your mother and do the right thing and go to school. And I'm just like, yo, what about this? Yo, what about that? Can I get a knife? And he's like, what? He started crying, bro. He was like, yo, you got it wrong, Shannon. This ain't for you, man. And I felt like him saying that to me was a diss. I felt like he was like saying, I couldn't hold it down. Like, you know, like I wasn't tough enough. Mm-hmm. And that angered me. You know, it angered me. It bothered me. I was like, oh, you think, you know, I'm light skinned. I can't fight. I ain't gonna be it. He was like, it ain't about that, Shannon. He was like, yo, this kid's in here 16, 17, they never going home. You know what I'm saying? They never going, they play tough when they get in here, Shannon. It ain't that, it ain't like you think it is. And I'm thinking the whole time I'm being defiant. And that was the last time I seen him. He wound up dying in Marcy. You know, he had wound up dying in Marcy. And, but, you know, a lot of people who knew him, they spoke highly of him. You know what I'm saying? You know, I started boxing. And you know, I was boxing. I was getting into boxing, but then I got, you know, I just got good. I made it on the USA team, and he was like, he was proud of me. He was telling, that's my son. And he watched the TV in jail, and he's like, that's my son. And it was an experience for me to go there and see him. And I never forget, you know, to see him cry, because he was such a tough dude. To see him cry was something for me. That made me kind of like realize that, yo, maybe I'm on some stupid shit. But again, everybody was going to jail like it was like rites of passage. Like, if you ain't go to jail, you wasn't cool, you wasn't down, you know what I'm saying? So I know people was catching charges just to catch a charge, just to be like, yo, go to jail, I seen so-and-so. But it wasn't nobody I know came back and was telling the real truth, you know what I'm saying? They wasn't really telling the truth. They were telling stories, oh yeah, I've seen so-and-so, but it wasn't telling you if they was washing drawers, or it wasn't telling you if they got gutted, you know what I mean? So, you know, it was what it was. So I was fortunate, man. I got into the boxing shit, and I made a life for myself, man. I got my mom's to rehab, and I got some money and shit, and then unfortunately she relapsed. On my birthday she died, and you know what I'm saying, my pops wanted to die in the prison. But I say all that to say, lads, you know, that made me who I am, because a lot of people don't realize that, you know, it ain't just street tough that make you somebody. You know what I'm saying? You gotta be tough not to do crime. You know what I'm saying? Like, they don't understand that. A lot of boys don't understand that.
Yeah, they don't know that's the real. That's the crime shit is easy, bro. It's easy to not give a fuck. But when you gotta stand tall and try to do things the right way, that shit is difficult. You feel what I'm saying? That's the difficult shit. And that penitentiary shit, bro, that shit is a hustle that's just making billions of dollars off of the pain and the suffering of people from the ghetto. You feel what I'm saying? So that jail shit gets glorified in some lights, but in the reality, that shit is a hustle and a new age form of slavery. That if a dude was lucky enough to escape that grasp, that's a blessing, my bro. Because so 1 in 3 black men is gonna go to prison, and that's disgusting, bro. That's disgusting. You feel me? And the life that you had. The shit that you just told me, and some of the stuff, you know, I've heard about, but the shit that you, the picture that you just painted, bro, you got dudes that did 20 years in jail that ain't go through half of what you've been through. You feel what I'm saying? So it's like, sometimes Brownsville, sometimes the streets of Brownsville and Brooklyn in general was worse than a penitentiary.
You know what I mean? That's a fact. That's real talk. So I can tell you, I can say it for days, telling you so many war stories in Brownsville. I'm lucky to be alive, but I will say this. I started boxing last, right? So then they had this program where you go to jail to box the inmates. You know what I'm saying? It was a dude. What was my man name? I ran into a dude from my neighborhood, and this was life-changing for me, Laz. I'm going to keep it honey with you. Like, this was life-changing because I was still on some knucklehead shit. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if you know the name from Brownsville, OG Nuke.
Yeah, I heard that name before.
Yeah. Now, you got to understand, Nuke was a legend in the hood. Like, up the hill, you know, you got Brownsville, you got up the hill Brownsville, Ocean Hill Brownsville. So, it's a whole different world up there. Alright, so yo, there was a man, I'm terrible with names, so I apologize. He used to do the shit, he was a CEO or something. His name was Bob. Oh man, I forgot his name. But he used to do the show. He used to take the amateur boxers up to Sing Sing to box, you know what I'm saying, against the prisoners. So I never forget, we went up there, man, I fought this dude. From Sing Sing, he was a grown-ass man. I might have been like 16. It was the first time I went up there. And the reason why I was trying to go too, I told him I was trying to see my pops. You know what I mean? I was like, damn, my pops might be that. Because, you know, I'm just thinking prison, I'm fine. So I go there, and I took an L. I took a bad L. So I was like, yo, these dudes can fight. So I never forget, they gave us a tour of the prison. And we walked through the you know, where they sleep at, the bunks and all that. And it wasn't bunks, it was like pods, like, you know what I'm saying? It was an open dorm, and they were showing us everything. You know, this is where they sleep at, this is where we sleep at, this is where we eat at. I was like, yo, this is crazy. And then, on my second go back, I ran into a dude from my neighborhood, and this was life-changing for me, Laz. I'm gonna keep it honey with you, like, this was life-changing, because I was still on some knucklehead shit. I was still on some knucklehead shit, man. I'm still trying to, you know, make a name for myself, make some money, more importantly. And then I had ran into this dude named Nuke. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if you know the name from Brownsville, OG Nuke.
Yeah, I heard that name before.
Yeah. Now, you got to understand, Nuke was a legend. Like, up the hill, you know, you got Brownsville, you got up the hill Brownsville, Ocean Hill Brownsville. So it's a whole different world up there. It's a whole different world. Like, I see your story with MOP and all that. You know, so I was crying, laughing and stuff, because I grew up with them. I grew up with Ballet. I grew up with all of them. Brian and Fada, Pooch, all of them. I grew up with all of them. My aunt is from Plaza. My family lived in Plaza. My aunt used to own the fish fry on St. John's in Ralph. So, again, I'm everywhere. I know everybody. I'm everywhere. So, still safe. You know, I'm in Brownsville. I feel safe. I know everybody. So, Nuke was a legend. You know, at the time, he was young himself. He might have been 17, 18, and I might have been, shit, I don't even know, like 12, 13, or whatever it was. He was, you know, he was big time doing his thing. He used to come through with the cables, big dookie ropes on his neck, no shirt on. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, damn, what kind of animal is this? You know what I mean? So, bro, he used to come through. So everybody used to respect them, got mad love for them. Like, yeah, I want to be just like that. So now I'm fast forward, I'm 16, whatever, 17, whatever. We go to Sing Sing to fight them. What was it, Bob Newman? Nah, it's on country, bud. So we go up here and I see Nuke. So he don't know me, I'm just a shorty from around the way. I'm looking at him, I'm like, yo, that's Nuke, I can't believe it. But I had heard he had got locked up and some shit like that, you know, here to the street. So somehow, we talking to the box, they talking to the boxers, we in this big-ass gym auditorium with the fights and all, and they was like, yo, why you ain't fighting? I was like, yo, some shit happened, I ain't having fighters, they had like for me to fight, something happened. So, I'm talking to Nuke, I said, yo, you from Brownsville, right? He looked at me, he's like, yeah, I'm from Brownsville. What's up, Shorty? Where you from? I said, I'm from Atlanta Towers. So, oh, word? He said, yo, shit, come here, yo. Yo, shorty from around my way, come here, y'all. Yo, shorty, tell him about me. I'm like, oh, nah, this is the man. This new, whoa. I'm fascinated, so I never forget asking him. I said, yo, new, how much time you got? He said something crazy, like 135 years. So I was like, what? Damn. So I was like, all right, cool. Now, mind you guys, that him telling me that, it kept me out of prison. Because after that, after seeing Nuke there, after that tour and all that, I was like, nah, this ain't it. You know what I'm saying? And he was always on my mind, bro. I'm sure he never, you know, whatever. I never talked to him again. No, I just figured he got life in prison, 135 years. That's it. So over time, I would ask him, yo, remember Nuke from Plaza? Like, yeah. I talked to Nuke, whoa. So about, shit, I want to say about 4 years ago, champ, 3 or 4 years ago, my cousin Sting, he just came home from the feds, he just did 18. I was like, yo, man, remember Nuke back in the day? He was like, yeah, Nuke home. I said, you bugger, ain't no way he home. He told me, I was 87, 88. He said, yo, I got 135 years. He told me my face. I said, where? He said, he home. So I couldn't believe it. Somehow we reached out. I reached out and he got in touch with me. I said, yo, do you remember me? He said, come on, man. What you talking about? He was like, yo, we watched all your fights. Remember you came up here, blah, blah, blah. I'm telling people, yo, that's shorty right there that was up here. Whoa. I couldn't believe it, son. So, and I told him, and to this day, that's my big bro. And to this day, we just spoke 2 days ago. I said, yo, champ. I said, I want to thank you, man, because you kept me out of prison. Not even my pops. You, seeing you in there, you telling me that? Now, you home, it's all good. But I said, yo, every time I went to get in some trouble, champ, I thought twice, lads. I said to myself, chill, champ. Don't do it, my boy. 135 years. You know what I mean? So that's what that kept me here, man. And then I was able to get on in this boxing shit and make a life for myself and have a family. You know what I mean?
That's deep, bro. That's deep.
Sing Sing. You was in Sing Sing?
Nah. I used to go up there to see my man though when he was locked up in Sing Sing. My other man from the Ville. I've been up there a couple times. What you say about it? I mean, I got a story on my page too about another one of my mans from my peas that was in Sing Sing. That's like one of my favorite stories. Shit gruesome though. Know what I mean? Shit is gruesome, but you know, Sing Sing is like the max that everybody want to be in, man. Because it's like New York with a roof over it. That's what they call it. You feel what I'm saying? Okay. It's so close to New York City. You feel me? It's minutes from New York City. So it's no excuses.
You know, growing up, being from Brooklyn and growing up in that whole, you know, prison and mentality and environment, you know what I'm saying? You know, I think it's because it's obvious and it's evident that you're gonna get locked up if you're from Brownsville, you know what I'm saying? Eventually,
you're gonna
get locked up.
Hell yeah, or killed. Or killed.
Yeah, pretty much, man. I'm a blessed boy, man. I'm gonna be honest with you, man. I went through a lot of shit. I seen a lot of shit in Brownsville. I told you, my grandmother lived in the plaza, you know what I'm saying? So I was all over the Ville. I seen the worst of the worst. That's why, like, you'd be like, yo, you be going everywhere. You this, you that. I'd be like, yo, son, I'm from Brownsville, son. Real talk. No trying to, no braggadocious shit, but like, I seen so much. I seen people get their head blown off. I've been kidnapped because of my pops doing shit. I've been into all type of shit, man. I've been in all type of shit as a kid that kids ain't supposed to go through. You feel me? Usually kids like that go through what I've been through. They usually go the criminal route. And, you know, my biggest issue lies is that I got a short temper, you know what I'm saying? I got that Brownsville mentality, and if somebody do something to you, like, oh, he must think I'm pussy. So you're always kind of, like, ready to, you know, to show you ain't.
I was going to ask you that because, you know, I'm a light-skinned nigga too, man. Dude, you basically answered the questions in the story that you told tonight. But I was gonna ask you that before you said that. I was like, you think a lot of your problems, people think niggas that's light skinned got it easy, but that ain't the truth, bro. Niggas, when you light skinned, niggas be trying you every 2 seconds, man.
Nah, you that talking. If I was a handsome kid, pretty skin, you know what I'm saying? My mom's had me, and my name is Shannon. You feel me? So it was like, yeah, you target, you a fool, you know, you fool. So again, that being everywhere, knowing mad people was a plus. But I had to learn how to fight, you know what I'm saying? I would get disrespected just because I'm light skinned, you know what I'm saying? I would get disrespected, and then I got so used to fighting back that eventually people started saying, yo, chill, leave him alone. He cool, he gonna fight back anyway. So, but yeah, man, being light skinned, the target, man. I remember going down assignments on Belmont, I'm talking about 82, 80, 80, 83, you know, going to get a lumberjack with the hat to match and shit, you know. Getting chased by the whole, I don't even know where these boys are from. I'm talking about, like, I'm running with the bag, son. I'm running with the big ass bag with the coat. Man, my man told me, drop. I said, hell no, I ain't dropping this shit. I'm running with it. Man, that skid guy got away from the skin of my ass. I'm telling you, son, I used to go to Howard Pool. It was off limits. It was for Howard people, you know what I'm saying? But when our pool was closed, we used to go to Howard Pool, man. Jump in the pool, swimming. Never forget, I jump in the pool, Howard Pool. And they look at me like, I'm stupid, I don't got no shoes on. It was glass. Yo, glass. It was so much glass at the bottom of the pool, my boy. My feet was cut up. I got out of there. I said, oh, that's why they swimming with the sneakers on.
niggas was looking at you crazy for not having sneakers on in the pool.
They looking at me like, oh, we got one. He ain't smoking.
What year you talk about with that? Like, what year?
Man, this had to be early 80s, man. This had to be 81, 82. We walked down the hill to the pool, Howard Pool. Our pool, we closed up for whatever reason. And having a pool with Atlantic Towers, man, that shit was a target, bro. We had everybody from every hood coming up there, man.
I never been to that pool in my life. I knew better than to go to that pool, though. I knew better. I knew I was from down the hill. I ain't going to be up in no up-the-hill pool. That's a wrap.
Bro, that pool was a target, man. We used to have so many people coming up to that pool, man. We used to be like, damn.
That's what my man Suge was saying. My man Suge was like, they used to be sneaking niggas from Herkimer. They used to be sneaking into y'all pool, and that's how shit started getting popping. Like, know what I mean? But I'm like, damn. They like, yo, son, we ain't have no pool, son. Like, these niggas got their own pool. Like, we needed to get up. And then the nigga tell me he was going in y'all shit at nighttime when it was closed. Y'all wilding out.
Yeah, they used to come
out
of Herkimer. We used to have war with Herkimer. Man, that was a long war, my boy. That war went on for a long time, man. That's a long war, man. Once that shit was like, you know what I'm saying? That shit was crazy. But boy, I remember, like, you couldn't even go to Rockaway Avenue train station. You know what I mean? They'd be out there deep. I mean, I'm talking about, like, deep. At first, we used to call them the Ducky Boys. We used to call them the Ducky Boys. Because it'd be like, yo, we never knew where they was from. Because it was, they come out of, like, mad blocks. You know what I'm saying? We called them Herkimer, but they was from everywhere, son. Down the hill, I don't even know where it was. Like, the other side of down the hill, not towards Brownsville. Like, the other side, I mean, that's where Papoose and them was from. But, like, Bainbridge and all that, you know what I'm saying? And that's another thing. I had people who lived on Bainbridge. So, my man Chico family, they lived down there. So, I was always on Bainbridge. So, I'm walking down there. Oh, shit, Herkimer boys, the Ducky boys. I said, oh, man, boy, I'm talking about, bro, you don't know the pressure, man. It's enough. Yo, I tell people all the time, man, if you from the Ville, you got to have a little form of PTSD.
That's a fact. You know what I'm saying? I say that same shit. That's a fact. Ain't nobody, you cannot say you grew up in Brownsville and you got all screws, put all screws together correctly, bro. That shit fucks you up. You grow up in Brownsville, you're going to be fucked up for life.
Facts, man. I mean, my wife's from Clinton Hills, man. And sometimes, you know, we over the years, we don't beef back and forth for her. She said, oh, you think this, you think that? Why you thinking negative? And this, that, and third. I'm like, yo, you don't understand, yo. worst. She said, I think the worst case scenario. Yo, she said,
what it is
the worst thing happen.
We could count literally hundreds of people that we know that we grew up with that got murdered. Gunfire. So it's like we always paranoid. If you from the Ville, you always watching. Your head is on a swivel. You always watching everything, and you always going to think the worst because we done seen and heard about the worst happening so many times.
Nine times out of ten, the worst going to happen. You feel me? My wife, yo, you don't let nothing slide. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yo, I can't. If I do, I can't sleep at night. You feel me? I can't sleep at night. I know it's going to come back to haunt me. It ain't no way, like, yo, son, you can sleep. Somebody could, like, you know, like, in the Ville, somebody say somebody mad dog, they looking at you hard, and you look away. You know what I'm saying? You look away in fear. It's a wrap. You don't just violate yourself, because now he know, he smell weakness. Next thing you know, he waiting for you outside the store, running, or whoop, you know what I'm saying? So, like, I went from, you know, getting chased for your sneakers and fighting for your Pumas, and I told you to try to take the lumberjack. I'm stupid, champ. I went out and got a sheepdog. So don't ask me why I got a sheepskin. Coming up, you know what I mean? Everybody was getting sheepskins. I'm in the seventh grade. I get a grab. Now, mind you, this is some funny shit. I went to a little private school across the street from Marcus. It's called Risen Christ Lutheran School, right? It was right across the street from Marcus. It was like a little church. Yeah, I don't know if you ever seen that shit. You ever seen it?
I'm trying to think and picture it right now, but I think I know what you're talking about.
Right across the street from Marcus is Blake. 250 Blake. I went to that school, son. It was like a little private school. So Marcus is right across the street. It's on. When I'm talking about, it got so bad, they were like, yo, we got to let y'all out of school early. Because when we let y'all out, when Marcus get out, it's a wrap. Everybody's, it's just like, we just target. So going to this little school, right across the street from Marcus, it was crazy. Man, I remember one day, kid took my ski hat. Right, so I run up in Marcus. To get him. Fuck was I thinking? I chase him up in school, and then he stopped. He like, what you chasing me for? I'm like, oh shit, yeah, you're right. What am I chasing you for? that was a mission, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, I had a lot of fights, man. I tell people, I had 300 street fights, man. I lost 150, champ. Real talk. I had a lot of fights, man. It's amazing that my face, you know, I didn't get a start of face until I got earlier. Got later in life with my boxing and whatever. My face got scarred up. But as a kid, man, I had so many fights, man, where I had to protect myself. I never had an opportunity to not fight for myself. You know, take my bus pass. Now I gotta walk to school. Up the hill, all the way down the hill. You know what I'm saying? Now I don't got no bus pass. So now next time I get a bus pass at the beginning of the month, I'm saying to myself, I can't take it now. I can't lose this bus pass because it's winter time. I gotta walk. You know, bus drivers needed shit back in the days. You know what I'm saying? The bus was like literally 30 cents, 35 cents was the bus, what it cost. But damn, you see that shit? But dang, it was like a motherfucker out here. But yeah, son, I had to fight a lot, son. So it was odd, dude. For me to get into boxing was second nature, man. I guess it was something that was meant to be because I was fighting since a kid, man. I was fighting being light skinned in the mill. It's a target on your back, man. Everybody want to pick on you and fight. Like I tell my wife, man, like, I can't let shit slide. If I let shit slide, you're going to think I'm pussy. And then next thing you know what I'm saying? You're going to try to take advantage of me. So, you know, if I see an ant, I step on it. An ant. I'm talking about an ant. They say, well, it's just an ant, so what? I don't trust nothing. They show me that ant might go get some more ants. You know what I'm saying? So, I was like, I don't trust nothing. Everything get killed. I ain't playing with nothing. You know what I mean?
That's real, bro. That's real, man. Real talk, bro. I appreciate the shit out you, man, for giving me these jewels, man. I mean, and I'm sure everybody in the whole Brooklyn gonna appreciate that shit, especially when I throw that Brooklyn legacy on there. You feel what I'm saying? Everybody gonna tune in and love that shit, man. I mean.